some music or even in this street.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to St. Oswald's. Welcome to those joining us at home as well. We're going to start our service today with our first hymn. If you'd like to take the hymn books and turn to number 617. 617. Stand up for Jesus. And if you'd like to stand and feel able, please do. Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from sin and turn to the Lord, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. And Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If you feel able, would you like to stand again? Going to use the Peruvian Glory on page 4. I'm going to sing a line and you're going to sing it back. Just going to move the microphone. Move to this one.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to the Father.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to the Father.
To God be glory forever.
To God be glory forever.
Alleluia, amen.
Alleluia, amen.
Alleluia, amen.
Alleluia, amen.
Glory to God, glory to God, Son of the Father.
Glory to God, glory to God, Son of the Father.
Genesis. Realizing that thy father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers, the wrong they did in harming you. Now therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way he assured them, speaking kindly to them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Psalm 103, the response is, "The Lord is full of compassion and mercy." Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is written within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
Who forgives all your sins and heals all your infirmities? Who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with faithful love and compassion?
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
Who satisfies you with good things, so that your youth is renewed like an eagle's? The Lord executes his righteousness and judgment for all who are oppressed.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
He made his ways known to Moses and his works to the children of Israel. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great kindness.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
He will not always accuse us, neither will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our wickedness.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy upon those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he set our sins from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so is the Lord merciful to those who fear him.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
The second reading is from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarrelling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall. And they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honour of the Lord. Also those who eat in honour of the Lord, since they gave thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in honour of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. If you feel able, would you please stand as we sing our next hymn, number 132, 132. Father, hear the prayer we offer.
Shift to
to our usual pattern for the service, I'm going to ask you to be seated for just 5 minutes as we hear from Peter, representing our Eco Church group, about this week's instalment of our information and our teaching and learning for Creation Time, which is this season running up to harvest. Welcome, choir. I don't need to prompt anyone. We're all going to come down there so we can see what's on the screen and listen to what Peter is saying, and then we'll have our gospel reading.
Good morning, everyone.
You just need to switch the microphone on.
Oh, it's off, Frank. I was going to ask. Sarah's correcting me now. Thank goodness. Where would we be without Sarah on technology? Well, we'll find out next year. This is Stan. Those of you who are here at the start of Creation Tide will recognise Stan. Stan is the grandson of Steve, who leads our Eco Church group. And during these weeks up to harvest, Stan has been encouraging us to think about various ways in which mankind is harming God's creation. Stan is particularly concerned, as we should be, about plastic. And this picture, I think, expresses the fate of children across the world, those who can only live on landfill sites, sorting out plastic, trying to earn income for their parents and food for their brothers and sisters. If you want to know more about the way that plastic is a worldwide problem, remember the charity name Tear Fund. If you go online with Tear Fund, you'll find there's a rubbish campaign. And it's really very clear. There's a very brief video, which we can't show you this morning, despite Sarah's mess up. We've another one coming, don't worry. But go on Tear Fund, you'll find there's a campaign there where they are enabling us to sign petitions to governments across the world to try and find a solution to the worldwide problem of plastic. Bear in mind, all the plastic that's ever been produced in this world never decays, so we have to find ways of dealing with it. It's not just a worldwide problem, it's a UK problem. This beach isn't on the shores of China. This beach is in Cornwall. These beaches, Steve asked us to put in the presentation because other grandchildren of his who live in Italy are seen here cleaning plastic off the beaches by the beautiful blue Mediterranean Sea. It's everywhere. And it's floating in our seas and in our rivers. And fish try to eat it. Not a very pretty slide, but reminding us that plastic breaks down into small pieces and ends up in the gut of fish. Need I say more? It's not just a local problem in our seas, it's a local problem in our rivers. And yes, that's just up the Calder at Stanley Ferry. The amount of plastic that comes down, especially in the flood seasons, and lines the riverbanks and blocks these sieves, is scary. This heron could be living on St. Aidan's Nature Reserve, looking at what it might think is a tempting piece of plastic. And it could end up like this, unable to feed itself properly as a tub is speared on its beak. And now, Sarah, can I rise to the challenge? We've got a video that we want to show you. I'm going to minimise that. I'm going to hope that I can find it.
If you press escape.
Oh, that was it. You just cannot get this down. So, tell me this.
Keep scrolling right.
No, keep scrolling right. That was it.
Keep going.
Keep going.
And it's not there. Have we got it? Right. So, here we go. Supposed to happen. To those of us who are visiting today,
it's not always like this. It's only like this when Peter's trying to work technology.
Are we back where we want to be, Sarah? Oh, there we go. A slide from Tear Fund, helping us to think what Jesus might think of our rubbish problem,
of what we're doing to our world. He spoke about injustice and about our relationship with the things that we own, the things that we buy, the things that we consume. So, what can we do to help God's creation? Well, I've mentioned that there is this worldwide petition run by the charity Tear Fund, and I'd urge you to look online, see what they're doing, and sign up. The video we've just seen came from our own Canal and Rivers Trust, and their campaign is looking for donations. The government has cut funding to that body. You can make a donation and receive a kit to help you help clear plastic. We can generate less ourselves. We can use a reusable bottle and not use plastic for our drinks. And we can deal with those irritating bits of recycling messages that say, recycle with bags at your large supermarket. So what we're trying to do is encourage you, if you forget to take it to the supermarket, bring it to church. And I've already filled a bag this week. See what you can do and bring it to church. And finally, very locally, and to be encouraged by Steve, who leads them, but can't be here today, we have our own group, the Medley Wombles, who go around our roads and our riverbanks collecting litter, particularly plastic. So you could join Steve, there he is, and Uncle Bulgaria. You could come a wombling with the Wombles and clear our verges and riverbanks of plastic. If you let me have your contact details later on, we can add you to the list. So go wombling free. Thank you.
So hear the gospel of
our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. And I'm reading from Matthew chapter 18. Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times. Jesus said to him, "Not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one slave who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he couldn't pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children, all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before the lord, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I'll pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves, who owed him just 100 denarii. Seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused, and he went and threw him into prison until he paid the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. And then his lord summoned that first slave and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slaves as I have mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he paid his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, I promise. May the words of my mouth, the thoughts of all our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, Lord God, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. As we've heard already from Peter, different Peter, from the one mentioned in our gospel reading, about the importance of looking after God's creation, I'm going to give us just another short reflection based on our gospel reading and our other readings today, just to be thinking on, as well as these other important matters from Peter. There's a lot to take in from all the readings today, and I recommend, if you can, to take this home. It's got the readings on it and the information on the back about church. Take it home and read it again and see what you make of them as you read them through and see how it might apply to your own lives as well. There's a lot, especially in the Gospel and those readings from St. Paul in the letter to the Romans, about both forgiveness and about judging each other. Forgiveness and about judging. We know that both these things are very powerful and can have massive impacts on those around us. Perhaps you yourselves are very aware of a time when someone has withheld forgiveness from you. They've not forgiven you for something. And when you felt unable to forgive yourself, perhaps you also were thinking of a time when someone has forgiven you. Maybe you didn't even think you deserved it, but they forgave you. They gave you more chances. We know that forgiveness is very powerful and has a massive impact. And Jesus knew all this too, which is why I'm sure he chose to tell this parable, this story, to Peter and the crowd who were gathered there on that day, all about the impact, the power of forgiveness. I just want to point out, he's not saying that 77 times is the maximum limit for the number of times you should forgive someone. He's using it as a multiplication of 7. So he's saying not 7, but loads times 7, loads more than that. Keep forgiving one another. And the story is of a man who owed a ridiculous debt to the lord of the manor. He owed what would have been millions of pounds in today's money. No one can pay that back. It was ridiculous. And so the lord forgave him, even though he'd got himself into this mess somehow by mismanaging the funds and by racking up these massive debts. But then what happens is that man doesn't pass on that forgiveness of that debt. He himself is owed money by other people, which is partly how he's racked up this debt, and he doesn't pass that on. Instead, he grabs the first person he sees that owes him money, drags him towards him, and screams in his face, "Pay what you owe me." And when he won't, he chucks him into prison. Because he
can't pay, doesn't pass on that forgiveness to the people around him. And of course, the Lord who forgave him at first is then very strict with him and demands the money back. He wants payment in full. Forgiveness is a really powerful thing. And another powerful thing that can impact us hugely is judging one another. We all do it. We all make snap judgments or long-term judgments, sometimes for good reasons, sometimes not. We all do it, and we've all also been affected by people judging us. I'm sure each and every one of us knows what it's like to be judged, and perhaps judged unfairly as well, or at least judged unfairly in our opinion. Paul has a lot to say about that to the church in Rome, who were facing lots of disagreements on very particular topics at that time around what it was okay to eat and what it wasn't okay to eat. That was the issue of the day, hence the discussion in that reading about meat and about vegetables that might seem a bit weird to us now. That was what was dividing them right then. And Paul reminds them that it is possible to coexist, to live alongside and even worship with people who have different views to us. And he's reminding them that ultimately that final judgment doesn't come from either of them, either of those groups. It comes from Jesus, from God. That we never know all the circumstances that have led to someone's decision. We never know everything about someone. So how can we judge another fairly? But God can, who knows all about us and knows everything. He reminds us to try, to learn, to criticise actions, to condemn actions where we need to, where they're hurtful of others, but not the people. But not the people. It's a lot for us to think about. The power of forgiveness, the power of judging someone and probably getting it wrong, the hurt that can be caused, and the lightness that can be given from forgiveness. We reflect on the fact that we can be forgiven all that we've done if we turn again to God, if we are sorry. And what a powerful thing for us that is, probably even beyond our understanding. Maybe if we let God's forgiveness gradually change us, we'll find ourselves more readily able to offer it to others. So something else for us to think about, looking after God's creation and looking after the people in it by reminding each other of that forgiveness from God and by trying our best to not be the judge and jury of each other on all kinds of little matters, but trusting that to God, big and small. Amen. And if you turn to page 7 in your books, and if you feel able, please could you stand with me just for a moment. Let's affirm our faith together. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took on human nature, died for us and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son and Holy Spirit. Amen. So please do be seated. And I'm going to lead us in prayer this morning. So let us pray. And let's begin by calling to mind the images and the accounts of the effects that our waste has on our world. Gracious God, we thank you for this beautiful world that we have to live in. We ask that you help each of us to think about the effects we have on the world for others, that we can do our part, even if it seems very small, that these things add up to care for our world and leave it in a much better condition for future generations. And we We pray for the big industries that are often very polluting, for changes in policy to reduce that impact on our environment, especially on our rivers and canals. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world, for the people who live in it. We know that there are many who face terrible times in this last week or two. We pray for those who've been affected by the earthquake in Morocco, the horrendous floods in Libya, and flooding in other parts of the world as well, and those who face terrible fires. We pray for those who've lost loved ones. We remember the many who died. And we pray for those who are now trying to rebuild and to make areas safe again for those who live there. Lord, we pray that aid can reach even the places that are really cut off. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we call to mind all those we know who are not well today. And we pray for those who we don't know, but you do, Lord, those who are struggling at home or in hospital or maybe residential care. We pray, Lord, for healing, for comfort, for companionship and friendship as well, for reassurance and for hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we lift before you, Lord, all those who are grieving, those who've lost loved ones recently, for those perhaps preparing for funerals or for memorial services, for those remembering their loved ones today with heartache as well as gladness for the time that they've shared. We pray, Lord, for your light to shine on them even in the darkest moments, and for your hope to bring strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, we pray for our churches here in Methley and across our team in Rothwell and Ulton and Woolsford and Lofthouse and the wider area, that we can be beacons of hope and of light and of change for the better, Lord. We pray that we can bring your love and your forgiveness to our communities. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Stand again. We're going to share God's peace together. God is love, and those who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's offer each other a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you all. Let's say peace be with you. To those around us, you can do a handshake or a wave if you like. Peace be with you all. And peace be with you at home as well. As we prepare to share communion, we're going to sing our next hymn. This one is number 1039, Colours of Day.
Thank you.
Wise and gracious God, you spread a table before us. Nourish your people with the word of life and the bread of heaven. Amen. Please turn to page 15 in your books. Page 15. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks to our God.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his heart of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, he supped with his friends, he took bread and gave him thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave him thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for us. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. And with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in Christ. Continue on page 19. Please do be seated. So let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. God's holy gifts. For God's holy people, Jesus Christ is holy, Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God's Father. Amen. who's being baptized is welcome to receive communion if you wish. We can bring that to you if it's difficult to come forward. And you're also welcome to come forward for a blessing if you would prefer. We do have gluten-free communion wafers available.
Thank you.
perpetual mercy, and because without you our human frailty cannot but fall, keep us ever by your help from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable to our salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. We pray our parish prayer, Spirit of God, move among us, hear and listen. Make us one in heart and mind. Make us one in love. Humble, caring, selfless, sharing, Spirit of God, fill our lives with your purpose and love. Amen.
Two things. You've been hearing about our eco church group. One of the things we love to do is to tend what we think of as God's acre, the churchyard. And we are busy encouraging wildlife and studying behaviours out there in the churchyard. One of the ways we're doing that, with the help of a neighbour, is studying the behaviour of bats, the presence of bats in the churchyard. Not, I'm happy to say, in the belfry, but in the churchyard. And tomorrow evening, Sarah Hoyle, who is a qualified ecologist and a neighbour of ours, will be doing another survey of bats, and she was very happy to have any of us who are interested, adults or children, to come out, joining us here at 7:15 as it starts to get dusk, and to be able to listen to the sounds of the bats as they flit around the trees. It's fun, isn't it, Sarah? So come along, join us in the garden members at about 7:15. And we'll see what we can hear and see. That's number one. Number two is that many of you are aware that we are now opening the church through the month of October, through the church, sorry, we're opening the church through the rest of the month of October on Wednesdays and on Sundays from 2 till 4. A couple of vacancies have arisen in the rota. If anybody would like, well, I think it was the pleasure of sitting in this lovely space for 2 hours, usually having some visitor drop in, maybe just to light a candle, sometimes people interested in our heritage to call in. Would you let me know, and we'll add your name to the rota for October. Thank you.
I'd like to say thank you to all those who were looking after the church yesterday and today and last weekend, as it's the Heritage Weekends at the moment, especially yesterday when we had the free company, the Medieval Reenactment Group, who came to join us and were camped out in the churchyard. Some of you might have had the chance to speak with them. It's very kind of them to come and do this. You know, they don't make any charge, they just come because they love it, and they tell people all about the medieval history of not just St Oswald's, but the surrounding area as well, that most of us don't know an awful lot about. And especially thanks to Peter as well for coordinating it all, with ably aided by Stuart, both doing tours to different groups. And you'd be surprised what there is to learn about our church. There's so much history in here, and we're so used to seeing it that we've almost stopped seeing it. But we're really blessed with all the treasures we have here. So if you want to come and learn more, Stuart and Peter, amen. If you'd like to learn how to do those tours yourself, they'd be very happy to train up more tour guides with the booklets that we have. Last thing for me, I think, is just to say harvest is coming up soon. 2 weeks' time is our harvest service, 1st of October. It'll be an all-age. And are we collecting donations for the local food bank, or CAP, one or the other? We're certainly collecting donations of food. I'm looking at Peter in case he knows. But it needs to be tinned food or dry food, you know, things like, you know, breakfast cereal, rice, biscuits, tins of soup, all those things, not
fresh food, so it doesn't keep very long to give out. So thank you for those. And Harvest Supper is the following weekend after that, on the 7th, and we've got tickets available for what is a great evening. Any other things to mention? It's Messy Church this afternoon. Anne would be very cross with me if I didn't say that. Messy Church this afternoon, 3:30 in the church hall at St. Margaret's. Everyone's welcome. Let's sing our final hymn. We've come towards the end of our service. Our final hymn is number 857, 857, I the Lord of Sea and Sky. Peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.